Hello, my name is Tom Cronin. In 1991 and 1992, I conducted a comprehensive series of interviews on camera with a diverse, often eclectic cross-section of Orleans residents. Some I knew personally, others I had never met. All had a solid connection to Orleans. The intent of these interviews was to record through the eyes of the people and their experience, their history of the town. Funding for the series was provided by a generous grant from the Community Preservation Council of $18,000 and a further contribution of $12,000 from American Heritage Realty, now Cape Cod Ocean View Real Estate. I sincerely hope you enjoy our series, In Those Days, Historic Voices of Orleans.
Let me in. The geese aren't too happy.
You stand over there somewhere.
Are these turkeys really as stupid as people say they are?
Just a little bit. They don't have too much going for them.
So how many do you have this year?
There's 11 here. 11 out of 15.
How heavy are they running this year?
Probably 25 pounds.
Thanksgiving's a week away. So these guys have got what? A couple more hours?
Well, we'll take them up in the morning and they'll be gone by 10 o'clock.
Have you got them all sold and
all accounted for?
Uh-huh.
Yeah, they look kind of nice out here in the open. I gotta have a bigger pen for them next year.
How many years have you had turkeys? You've had them
20 years.
Oh, you have?
Oh, yeah. We used to have them over there, at Dan's place. Over next, remember when I had the pigs over there? I had the turkeys. I used to have bronze turkeys. I had them over there. Then I moved them up here. Oh, they're so happy out here. The guy, when he cleans them tomorrow, he's gonna find, not gonna find any grain in their crop. He's gonna find all these little sticks. And he's gonna say, what the hell have you been feeding these guys? Look at that stupid one over there, see him?
As opposed to the other ones.
I have one of them here, I call him Don. And the reason I call him Don is that I have a little door in the back of the hen house, or the turkey house, that they go in. And it's about, 12 or 14 inches high. So this big turkey, he wants to get in the door. See, and he goes up to it, you know, and his head is 3 feet high. And he can't, the door is only a foot high, so all he sees is shingles. He can't find the door. Every night, all the others duck down and go in. But this one guy, he stays up there, and I have to grab him by the neck, put his neck in, and push him in. I call him Don because he reminds
Don?
Don. He reminds me of a guy I know from Florida. Pilot type for the airport. He's that type. I think I'll make the pen bigger next year. I didn't big enough. And I think I'll put some pallets down. See, I got some pallets over there. I'll put a whole bunch of them all over, and then I can hose them down from time to time. Keep the pen a lot cleaner.
Not that time, you gobbled them out.
They work pretty good if you get them to spread their wings.
So you have the Christmas tree.
Here one night, and the raccoon is sitting inside the pen, and the turkeys are all outside.
So then what happened?
Well, I have the light on inside. They're all outside, so I just went and got my gun, and I shot him inside the pen. Another one I shot outside the pen. He was just sitting down, kind of discussing things with the sheep. They were just parked there, and I put the light on them, and pairs of eyes at the sheep, and here's the fifth pair of eyes, and I look twice, and there's a little coon looking at me. This guy here was one of quadruplets, and I bottle fed him when he was a baby, so he gets along with me pretty well.
How old is he, Frank?
He's, he'll be 3 years old this spring. Trouble is, you never want to turn your back on him.
Oh, yeah?
You know why they call him a ram. He turn your back on him and he'll just hit you. Boom. I know how to do it. That's good.
The rear admiral of the flock here.
He is. He's number one. Mm-hmm. It looks like 1,000, but he turned around and he's number one.
Which one do you want to buy?
Well, what do you want me to have?
I don't care. The smallest is 28 pounds.
Well, I'll take like a 30 pounder. This
is a 30 and a half. Take this one. We'll take that one.
Yeah, this one we'll take it off the end.
Okay. It's 29 pounds.
All right. I called Chattel. They have a few turkeys from Sandwich that they're getting $2 a pound for. But that's retail price that they're getting, $2 a pound.
Retail, yeah.
Yeah.
But so we think we'll charge $1.50 because people will buy a 25 pounder but they don't want a 29 pounder.
Yeah.
So we'll charge $1.50 for what was saying. Or eight turkey, what, $45?
$45 for this then.
That's right.
Okay.
How's that sound?
Sounds good. And if anyone doesn't take their liver and gizzards and stuff,
you
let me know,
I'll
please.
I'll bring them to you.
Okay?
Yeah.
All right. So, you got another bag?
Yeah.
All right.
Yep.
Sarah, how did the loading go last night? Was it uneventful?
Uneventful.
There was no squawking?
No, I didn't hear a word all night. We just sat up there in the truck waiting patiently. What a big
trip.
A big trip.
And they went to the slaughterhouse in New Bedford?
New Bedford.
Is this the same place that slaughters pigs?
No, this is just for turkeys.
Oh.
And they're only turkeys. And all people coming in with this had a lot smaller turkeys than these. And this girl from Orleans had five. And she was so proud of them. Half the size.
These turkeys are a lot smaller than last year, too.
Well, we got them a month later so that they would be, hopefully. Because last year they were 40 pounds.
Frank, we're from the coalition of the Turkey Humane Society.
Welcome.
The turkeys have...
Welcome to the buoy room. Just, these are all little buoys here that look like turkeys.
Hey, these guys are still warm.
Of course. They're just recently deceased. We're letting them chill. You just let them chill.
I can't believe that yesterday they were walking around in the pen.
They came out good. They're good-looking birds. Yummy. Do you carve the bird yourself?
Yes. Yes, I do.
I insist on carving it.
Yes.
So how many did you have, Frank?
How many did I have? Birds?
Yeah.
We had 11.
11.
Yeah. Well, I started out with more, but several deceased during the season.
You mean, did we celebrate Thanksgiving early this year in the Joy household?
Not quite.
No. Two or three of them deceased when they were less than a week old.
30 pounds, 29,
20,
yeah.
I can't...
Thank you, good. Bye-bye.
I can't say I haven't noticed the difference. Pretty hard. You can't tell a male from a female.
P-A-I-R-D. That's the people who trees, yeah.
I'm impressed with the system here. You're organized.
This is...
Is that off of a male?
I think it is. Huh? It appears to be. Now, under here...
What is that?
Uh-oh. That's the heart and the liver.
Oh, those
that's the heart. That's not what you think it is. That's the heart. The liver.
It's a nice big heart.
You're all heart. So those are the hearts and the livers. These little guys here, those are the gizzards, we'll call them. And those are the necks.
Next.
I was kind of pulling your leg.
Yep,
that's them. They're all packaged up here for the 2, 4, 6, 8, 10. So I guess Dan, that is.
I don't know if you were born in Orleans or not. Were you born here?
Yes.
You were?
Yes, oh yes. Yep.
And where were you born?
Hyannis Hospital.
Uh-huh. But where did you grow up? Where did you live? Where did you first live?
We lived right on Monument Road. Well, actually, we lived on River Road, where Dr. Whitelaw, that little house of his, that was the first winter we were here, and I was a baby. And then we moved up to Monument Road. That's Kiskiowski's house, you know?
Yeah.
And he it was a barn that he brought over from East Orleans and put it over there on Monument Road. And that's what we lived in. And he kept adding on and adding on, fixing
this
it up.
This is Vernon.
Yeah. Oh, yes.
That's right. You're Sarah Joy now. You were Vernon Smith.
I'm Sarah Smith. Now,
do,
Sarah
do you
Joy.
You have brothers and sisters?
Yeah, I have an older sister and a younger brother. And I've lived on Monument Road all my life, one end of the road and up to this end of the road.
Wow.
So I certainly have seen Orleans and seen Meyer.
So I've never heard much about your mother. What?
She was an English lady and very cultured, lovely person. And she came from England. And she lived in Chappaqua, New York as a young woman. And her mother was English. And they met in Boston, I believe, through her sister. And they had a tea room, she and her sister. And Vernon was on Beacon Hill doing stage design, stage sets. And they met, and they came to Provincetown in the summer and had a little tea room, my mother and her sister. And tea rooms were in the 20s. And so that's how they met. And they were married quite soon after that. And they were living in P-Town. They moved up to Orleans when she started having a family. So that's how we got to Orleans. Mm. I think he thought it was a little too, you know, for family.
In Provincetown.
Even in those days.
So you went to school. Let's see, where was the grammar school?
That was down there where the town hall is now. That was grammar school. Mm-hmm. And then they had the high school up on the hill right across the street. And then they built the Nauset School over here.
You never attended the school?
Yeah, it was the first class.
Oh, yeah?
First class there, yep. There was Gaston and Phil Deshawn and all those people.
Uh-huh.
I was in two classes. I stayed back a year. I hate to tell anybody this terrible secret.
You?
Yeah. We went to Florida one winter because I was sick, and I didn't go to school all winter. And I was in Gaston's class and Milt Gray. So then when I came back, I had to stay back a year because I didn't have any schooling. So then I came into Eldridge's class, Elder Sparrow's class. So I was sort of always, both classes were my friends. But I did graduate.
Well, you had a good excuse, though. You went to Florida for a year.
We went down to Florida in the 30s. And I must have been about 10, 12 years old. It was the Depression. And it was a funny year. We had a great time. We were in Sarasota, and right on the beach. And no one went to Florida in those days. And we went down in an old Oakland. Which was
an
Oakland.
That's a baseball team.
That's a car.
It was a baseball team.
And it had the little vases in the sides of the in the back, little flowers growing. And we drove that thing down there, and everybody, it was very high. You sat real high. We looked down at all these cars that are getting this size now, but we were still pretty oaky ourselves, I guess.
Was it your father's It was his decision to want to go to Florida?
Well, Norman White used to go down. He was the only one, and he was in Miami, and he said, it's the greatest place to spend the winter. So that's what we did, and we were very broke. It was just terrible. But we had any money to come home, so I don't know how he got by that winter, but we had an awfully good time. But it was terrible, and we were finally eating pancakes without any baking soda in it so they wouldn't rise, they're just this rubber stuff. And the mail came, and it was a check for $500 from George Gershwin. He bought a painting. My mother packed the bags immediately. We got in the car, she said, I'm going back to Cape Cod, I'm not staying here another day. So that's how we got home on George Gershwin, thank God.
Would you describe Vernon, then, your father, as the typical starving artist?
Well, we never knew we were starving, but I imagine we didn't have any money, of course. And he was an artist, always primarily an artist, so he tried to make a living doing other things. And in the winter here, when the snow was on the ground, the town, hire you to dig the snow. And they didn't have any, they did it with shovels, the sidewalks and everything. And he did a lot of, he had a furniture repair business over there on Minot Road. And he and this other man, and they took furniture and they scraped it down, and redid it and everything. And then he did batik work, which I can show you some of his batiks.
You mean batik?
He called them batiks.
B-A-T-I-K?
Mm-hmm. You call them batiks? He said batik.
It's cloth.
Cloth.
Hand-painted designed cloth.
And he did those, and he sold them all everywhere. That was a big item. And I think he finally gave it up because he was afraid all those dyes and lye, they had to dip them in. I think he thought he was going to get cancer or something like that. I mean, it was in those days, it was that very powerful dyes.
Mm.
So he gave that up. And then he did aluminum work with Florence Kimball. They made buttons. I can show you some buttons. And they turned out thousands of aluminum buttons with little fish on them and sent them. They went to Macy's in New York to be sold. Over there, I think it was Bloomingdale's or one of them anyway.
Yeah.
And they sold thousands of them. They spent turning out these buttons.
Vernon came from the Boston area originally?
No, no, no. He was from Cortland, New York. And he went to this Art Students League in New York. And then he went into the war, World War I. See, he died in 69. And he was 75, so I don't remember what day that would be he was born. And he stayed in France after the war and studied in Paris. And then he came back here. And then he came to the Cape just sort of precariously, like, you know, came to Provincetown. And I think mainly he came to Provincetown, well, because my mother had the tea room.
He was absolutely devoted to his art.
And oh, yes.
Serious.
He always wanted to be an artist, and he always was that was a prime Mary thought in his mind that his work. So, but he had a family, and my mother had some money, or her family did, but she was very prideful and would never accept anything from them. So they struggled along in early Cape Cod, and they managed to do it all right.
I think it's fair to describe him as he was the artist of Orleans.
He was the art. There wasn't anybody else. I don't think there was any other artists here. They were in Provincetown. But he was the only one in Orleans, and he painted all Orleans scenes, and loads of them. And I have some albums with pictures of them, but it was during the WPA days, and he was working. That was when Roosevelt had all the artists go on a payroll, and in Provincetown and up here, and Vernon was a supervisor, and he went to Provincetown all the time for 2 or 3 years, picking up all the art, and it came to our house, and then it went to Boston, and it was all shipped over the country and exhibitions and things like that. All that art was kind of lost, I think. But that's where he painted primarily Orleans. He did a lot of that.
And he would receive a regular,
yeah,
monthly
get it every they get it. Yes, they would get it paid, but he would pick out the art. He'd go down to Provincetown and he'd see Fritz Fuchster and Phil Malico and Bruce McCain and all of those artists that were on the WPA, and he'd pick out the paintings and bring them up to our place and then take them up to Boston.
And so he would, in effect, select the work that
he was the one that decided whether they were going to get on the. He picked the artists and everything. He loved the outdoors, and he loved painting from sketch pads and then coming back and painting. And he had classes. That was the other thing in the summer here. He had all kinds of watercolor classes, life classes. He had a studio back of the house on Monument Road, and all these summer people came and took art lessons. Loads of them. Loads of the ladies today remember taking art lessons from Vernon Smith. Thinks he was wonderful. He had a way with him, with people. People just loved him. He was a very quiet, unassuming man, but they just loved him.
I know he gave away a lot of his work for favors, or if someone had helped him out, he'd show up with a painting or a carving.
Yeah, matter of fact, I have a painting in my bedroom of me, my mother holding me as a baby, and he gave it to Paul Henson because he delivered me, and Dr. Henson, over in Hyannis. And they gave it back to me a few years ago. And that was the way he paid for the delivery. He gave this painting.
When I think of Vernon and his work, is it fair to say that the wood panels are really what he was most known for? Or is that?
Probably, because you see, 1946, he stopped painting. He discovered my mother had MS.
And I didn't know that.
Yeah, so he used to sit by her bed and carve. You know, he started whittling, carving, and he got interested in it. Just all of a sudden, he became fascinated with wood. And that's what he started to do, and he never painted another painting. Would you believe that? Never. After 46, do I recall him doing a painting.
Wow.
So and then he made a very good living with these panels.
Did he do carved figures? Like, there's bird carving, has gotten to be a high level of art these days.
No, never did that.
He didn't do
that. He did a series of birds, little carved birds, the sandpiper with a long snoot, you know. And he sold a lot of those, but that's the only thing he did. Everything was this panel, a panel with the birds carved in it, but never did anything like an Elmer Kroll kind of a thing, nothing, no.
So that, I think those panels are really
That's what
unique it is. To him, really.
They are. They're very unique. But actually, in the art world, he did more in the art world. I mean, his paintings are in famous collections all over the place, but not carvings. I mean, he was in New York with Krausch Art Galleries for years, and she sold all his paintings, but not carvings. After he started to carve, he sort of just lost interest. I don't know. He just. Which a lot of people think his paintings probably were really more important than his carvings. But he made a good living at the carving. And so he did a lot of church work. Like he did Stations of the Cross. He did a big one up at Northeastern. And two big doors, carved doors for the church up there. That was his last carving that he did for the church, any church.
Did he ever go on to anything after those carved panels? Did he then evolve into another form of art?
No. No, he used to go to New Mexico in his last few years of his life. See, my brother lived out there. But his work was harsh. It wasn't like the flowing that you see in the Cape with the birds and the fish and the waves. I'll show you an example of it in New Mexico. It wasn't good. It wasn't good at all. It didn't seem to capture to me the feeling that that came out of these carvings that he did.
Well, I know of the few I've seen, the colors are harsh because of the reds and the oranges that you don't get around here.
Yeah, I don't think they were good, but he sold quite a few out there. Mm-hmm. And he had a dealer in Carmel that took most of his panels and paid him against the work, you know, and he collected them. And he had about, I'd say 40 at least. And then when he died, or when he got sick, I wanted to see if I could get some back. So we negotiated, and I had a gallery up here on this road for years, about 3 years, and sold his work from there to keep him for that little house that we had for him. And that's how we kept him going. I had to sell an awful lot of stuff, which I didn't want to do.
Yeah.
But we had to because it was very expensive. You know, we had to have a nurse taking care of him. So that's how we did it. And I'm glad he had enough work, you know, ahead of it. And I sold quite a lot of paintings, lots of drawings and sketches. And so I really, it's too bad, but I had to.
Yeah.
Because we didn't have, at that point, we weren't making enough money to support this whole thing.
One of the things that's really interesting, I think, is that he had a lot to do with the Church of the Holy Spirit on Niagara Road.
Mm-hmm.
Specifically, what sort of contribution did he make to that church?
Well, he was a very good friend of the Kimballs. As a matter of fact, the whole of Monument Road, the Kimballs and the Johnstones and the Smiths were all big friends. And Dick had this idea that it would be nice to have a little church. He was a writer and a poet.
This is Dick Kimball.
Dick Kimball.
Dick Kimball, for anyone who doesn't know, it's the one that
started the church, yes.
Of the Holy Spirit.
They had the Galley West, that little building up on the property. They had it moved. It was from Nauset somewhere. They had it put up there on that land, and that's where they lived. It was just that little, what they call the Galley West now. So they decided to build a little building after, you know, they'd had services at Mayflower and done all kinds of things. But in 1935 or 6, so Vernon designed this little church for them. They had carpenters and they built it with friends and with regular carpenters that were working at it through collections and donations. But Vernon basically designed that church, the basic as it stood originally.
Just the main portion that you see when we go through the front.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And did he do some of the physical labor too?
No, he could have, yes, probably did, because I used to go up there, we used to wander around, they'd be pounding nails. Yeah, I think he probably did. But then, of course, when the church had done, and he many years later, when he started carving, he did he did a lot of painting for them, a lot of things behind the altar, which they didn't like, and they didn't use, but now they have them in the church.
But carvings or paintings?
He did a painting with some aluminum on it. It's now in the back of the church when you look up, and it's a great big painting, two panels, as you're going out of the church. And it's the Tree of Life. and the dove ascending and descending. And it's a beautiful piece. I gave it to the church as a memorial. And but he did the carvings many years later, of course. And there's everything around there, the doors and the sconces, aluminum sconces, and the carvings on the pews, and the flame of life that's on the lectern. And his ashes are up there on a stone by in the church garden. And it's one of his carvings, a soapstone, one of the Stations of the Cross. And there's a little plaque on it. You can't see it unless you walk around back by the Kimball House, but it's there.
So it's behind where the Kimballs live, behind Galley West?
Mm-hmm. It's right there in the middle of the back of the parish house, and in that quadrangle or whatever you call it. It's right there where the little pond is, and they all worked together to build this church. And they had a great time doing it in those days. I guess it was, you know, they didn't have any money and no business really doing what they did. They didn't know any better, you know, Episcopal church, for God's sakes.
And Kimball wasn't even
a... No, he wasn't even ordained. He was in his 60s when he became ordained. I mean, and he never went to a theological school or anything. They gave him sort of a, let him take the exam at home. study it at home. But... And Florence, of course, was a big prime mover. She was a very, you know, just a dogmatic kind of a loud person, and just she pushed to get everything done and pushed people. And Dick was sort of sat back and sort of was the intellectual, but she was the one that really built that church. She probably pounded more nails than anybody. She was a very, very strong person. And they had their little goats up there, and they had their kittens, and they had... They had a lovely life up there. I remember my brother had a little printing press up there, and he printed this newspaper called the Kimballtown Clarion, and he set all the type the old-fashioned way, you know. And he learned all, and he still does it to this day, has a little printing press and does his Christmas cards on it and things like that. But he did that up there. And I don't think I have a copy of it, but told about all the gossip on the road and who's doing what, you know.
Malcolm Hobbs told me, for instance, that Vernon designed the masthead of the Cape Codder.
Yes.
And when you know that, and you look at the masthead, you can see Vernon.
His the way he drew.
The way he drew, his style. He carved the sign out in front of the Cape Codder newspaper building, which I was never aware
of. Didn't know that.
The minute that Malcolm told me that, as I was going out of the building, and I looked and I could see, yes, that's something...
He did the Sea Scout catch. On the bow, there's an Indian head carved on the bow of the Sea Scout catch.
That carving at the library is magnificent.
Isn't that beautiful? That was an early one. He did it almost one of the first ones he ever did, would you believe? It's a beautiful piece. It's a memorial for my mother. After she died, he did the carving and gave it to the library in her memory. He did that, and that's, of course, the sea, with a woman coming out of the sea with her hair, you know. I don't know if you've looked at it closely. The sea around us. Mm-hmm. She is our mother. Mm-hmm. And he did do that for her.
You were describing Monument Road to me, that in that period that we've been talking about, in the 30s and so forth, that was really a interesting artistic stretch of
it was.
Orleans.
It was.
There were a lot of interesting artistic people that lived along the way.
They did. They were all very good friends. They sort of migrated there, and they all helped each other with their different endeavors, like Vernon's art, and Sally White Johnstone, who was had the Greenwood Theater there on that road, and she was a costume designer, and she had a business where she shipped out our costumes to Boston or to different shows and productions. And when he had the batik business, she made dresses and sold those. Batik dresses, they called them. And Lake Farm Camp, the people over there, they helped with the church and helped do the financial. And everybody helped everybody else with their little projects. They were, in a way, probably very small to most people, but it was important to them. And they really helped each other. And the Johnstones, they had the outdoor stage there, Vernon would do the stage design, the stage sets for Gilbert and Sullivan, Shakespeare. They did all kinds of stuff for about 4 years in the summers.
And where would this be held?
Well, you know where the curve of the road on Monument Road, where it curves? Right there, there's a right next to the Johnstones' house where Gaston used to live. After the Johnstones died, he inherited that house, you know, lived there. Uh-huh. That land there, that was an outdoor theater. And the cars, they parked from one end of Monument Road to the other. They came from all over the Cape to see these productions, and they were marvelous. Well, they'd sit on the ground benches. Oh, hundreds and hundreds of people. I mean, there must have been, I'll bet you, 300 or 400 to a performance. That was the only theater there was. Hmm. And people just loved it. Outdoors, you know, and they'd be flipping through the Robin Hood, you know, flying through the woods and all their costumes. It was, and of course, I learned, we all worked over there. We all sewed and we put things together. They had children's workshop theaters. So it was a very cultural road. What were the art? Was Vernon, and then the theaters. And then Norman White down in the lake, he had the camp. And it was just something going on everywhere. And the road was our life. We didn't have to go anywhere else. And they had a tennis court, clay court right there. The Johnstones did. And we all rolled it every day and played tennis. And we learned so much then that we do now. It's
that
carried over.
In the 40s, right, really?
Well, no, because I was married in 46, so it had to be, yes, in the middle 30s, this theater was on until the war broke out. So the war, I don't think it was going on after 1940. I don't think so. Hmm. No.
So the Academy Playhouse, that building was a town hall then.
That was a town hall, yeah. They didn't use that arena theater not until after the war. Hmm. So it was just the Greenwood Theater down there. And
the Greenwood Theater.
Greenwood Theater.
Mm-hmm. First time I've ever heard of that, and I've tried to pay attention to what's going around Orleans historically.
They used to have political rallies there. They'd have these benches and everybody come let's see who could be running, Roosevelt or whatever, you know, and she hated Roosevelt. So whoever was running against Roosevelt, she'd have him and everybody come and cheer and
for
make speeches.
Al Smith, maybe a relative.
Yeah, no. And the only way they met him, they had a ginger jar, and they passed around a ginger jar for a collection for the ticket money. That's how you paid. You just put your money, they didn't sell tickets.
What was the summer tourist scene like in the 30s?
They were people that had homes, summer homes. Didn't have the transient trade. They came for the summer, like Nauset Heights and Chatham. And you knew them, all knew them well. And they were the ones that sort of supported us, you know, with the art and the lessons and the children's classes at the Greenwood Theater, the drama classes and Vernon's art classes, and they bought the paintings and the batiks and the, you know, so they were very important to us. There wasn't any hotels, it was a hotel, I suppose the Southard Inn, but it was mostly, as I say, people here all summer.
So you'd have the Cochrans and Judge Brooks, mm-hmm. People out in Nauset Heights.
All those people out there, the Farnhams and all that crowd. Mm-hmm. And I can't remember all their names. And oh, down in Barley Neck, R.F. Nichols, all those people.
The people that are out on Poached Island.
Right, yep. Mm-hmm. Mm. Of course, there are lots of little houses along that beach. You probably seen pictures. Did you see those in H.K. Cummings' pictures? There are all those little cottages along on the dunes.
And some that weren't so little, but seemed pretty large.
Yeah, they had big porches on them.
Yeah.
They all washed away. We always had the ice man, the milk man, the knife sharpener, and the meat man. They all came. The bread man, deliveries.
Fish peddler.
The fish man. And everything, they came to your door. It was wonderful. I can remember when Vernon's father died, when, I don't remember when that was, probably and I think he owed somebody like Josh Nickerson, he owed him for some building material when he built the house over there, and he owed him for about 10 years, about $700. So when his father died and left him some money, he went right down, he wrote out a check to Josh Nickerson. Josh said, "No, Vernon, you don't owe that money. I mean, it's 7 years now. I mean, that's the debt is absolutely not." He insisted on paying it, but that was Josh Nickerson too. He'd written it off and never thought he'd ever see it, you know. Yeah. But people were helped everybody, each other. It was hard times here.
Did you used to have any summer romances?
Oh, no, we're not.
Any of the tourists that came into town?
Oh, yes. Oh, yes. All the counselors, you know, at the camps, Camp Viking. And
that's right. The camps were a major
Oh, that was summer. A big thing here. Big thing, the camps. That was supportive of our economy.
So the camps now, just trying to think about it for a minute, there was Viking and there was Camp Namaqua.
Yeah, and there's one in Tonset, Camp Tonset. Mm-hmm. Before that, it was another name that Norman White had over there. I can't remember the name of it.
Was Lake Farm Camp going?
Yes, Lake Farm was going. Quonset. Now they're all gone.
Yeah, they're all subdivisions. Mm-hmm.
So. We Cape Codders sold everything.
What do you remember that was downtown in the center of town? Let's see, the South.
H.K.
Club?
Yes, I remember. It was down by Sunoco.
Yeah.
Where Sunoco is now. Mm-hmm. I remember it, yeah.
You probably weren't allowed in there.
No, I was too young. I was just a baby, please. Just a baby. But no, that was a big social place, I guess. And of course, the Southward Inn was our big thing.
Yeah.
And you go to the barn on Saturday night.
Oh, yeah.
Square dancing and drink beer. And that was a big place to be. Mm-hmm. That was Al Rich's father, Dick Rich, South Orleans.
And Eve Rich.
And Eve took it over after he died. I know he died in 1946 because that was the year we were married, Frank and I. And he died the night after we were married because all the people had a big celebration and got raised hell down there. I always felt I felt that maybe we were responsible for Dick Rich's heart attack, I don't know. I always felt guilty about that. I don't know, you live here all these years, you grow with it.
Yeah.
You know, you're not aware of this change because you're always here. But I just remember being able to see all the way down to Nauset, you know, just fields and fields and little, and the scrub pine started coming and just, you know, overtook the Cape. But it was beautiful here. But it changed so gradually that you almost didn't realize it was gone when it was gone. Until you get older and look back on it. But growing up, you're busy and you're in your thing and everybody's trying to make a living and selling their land. And I mean, they say that the Cape Codders really sold their land. I mean, they had to. I mean, Josh Nickerson, he had all that land out there on Poche, remember? And
he took it over for a bad lumber bill.
Yep. And he built.
That was the first development in Orleans, Poche.
Right.
Poaching,
yeah. And he couldn't sell a lot for I don't know how many years.
Because it was so far out there.
Yes,
oh, out there. That's true.
Yep. We have the sheep farm. We have the only farm in Orleans. Isn't that wonderful? It really is very nice. We are considered a farm here. Mm-hmm. We have 5 acres of contiguous, I guess is the word.
I'm not from the IRS. You don't have to do that.
Well, I don't want to say that. Anyway, it's a nice little farm. We hope we can.
I pick up my Thanksgiving turkey here.
Mm-hmm. And you buy your eggs every week.
And we get our eggs. And I've had a Christmas goose or two.
Have
here.
You? Yeah. Yeah.
We have the sheep. Have I had lamb? I guess I've had
and
lamb.
Have you had some lamb yet? We sold something
lamb.
Like 5 or 6 lambs this year.
Turkeys. I think that the entire town was farmland at one point.
It was. I mean, you look at, well, Mayo's Duck Farm, and mm-hmm. you could see the whole, from the farm, you could see all the way down to the beach, and beautiful.
Grandview is where.
Yeah. Yeah, farm.
Concert Road, everywhere.
Oh, yeah.
Now, this is the last spot.
Yeah. When I have just a memory of Monument Road being a dirt road. I must have been awfully young, but the people who lived up the road were the Thickersons, or Collinses, Seth Collins, and he had a buckboard, a blue wagon, and I can remember sitting on the back of that wagon and going to town. I must have been very, very small, because it must have been paved soon after that. Mm. But he had a horse and wagon, so that was in the 20s, 1920s, and they were all farmers, that road.
I was talking to Roland Mayo, and he was telling me that his father used to spread oil and sand on the roads in New Orleans.
Maybe that's what they did.
With
yeah.
A team of horses. And
that's with how horses?
And that's how they would grade the roads, with a team of horses.
You're
involved in the theater down here at the end of Monument Road at the Academy.
Yeah, I've always been interested in theater. And so, the last few years I've been president of the Academy, and now I'm just on the board. Mm-hmm. But it's been an interesting experience, and I think
theater,
I'll be going off.
The theater is very successful now.
It is. It is. We have money in the bank, which is unusual for that.
For any theater to have money in the bank, any artistic group to have money in the bank is amazing.
So we're very, very proud of the fact that we got money in the bank, and we're going to do some repairs on the building and try to get it back in shape.
Mm-hmm.
Because it is a beautiful building.
Yeah.
And try to keep it, get it up.
Your son Dan, who's an artist, has done a lot of work.
Yes, he inherited his grandfather's talents, certainly inherited it, but went on to develop it. He's very talented. He learned
a lot. In a very similar way, it seems that he has gone around town and contributed to the art of Orleans. At the restaurant, for instance, the
big fishing surf boat, you mean?
Yeah. What's the name of the restaurant? The
Lobster Claw. Upstairs, he did a beautiful surf boat with the men coming through the surf, you know. They've never used that bar upstairs. Nobody ever sees it.
Hmm.
It's a beautiful thing.
The Arbor restaurant, he's done a lot of painting in that one room there. And in back at the Binnacle, done a lot of painting there.
Yeah, lived. He really has felt very close to him. And he's wanted to kind of be part of the community as an artist.
How well did Dan know Vernon?
Very well, because they were young children here. And he had his studio up here where Dan lives now. And Dan would be up there a lot, watching him carve and do all his things. No, he learned, and he'd stay with the kids a lot.
What I'm going to do is I'm going to unhook us and mm-hmm. walk around. But there's one last thing that I want to ask you, and that is that I did an interview, you know, I was telling you, with Dave Gesford at the mm-hmm. tennis tournament. And he's kind of, I guess you could say he's kind of the father of modern tennis around here in Orleans. But if he's the father, you're the queen.
It's Prescott Townsend, this friend. He was played at Harvard, and he came down here, and he taught me how to play tennis as a young girl. And then I didn't play after I was married until the kids were all grown up. So then I picked it up again, just for exercise, mm-hmm. and I've enjoyed it ever since. I played a lot, and Frank built us a tennis court here.
But then you had that court, the clay court you're telling me about on Monument Road. I'm mm-hmm. not even sure of the location of that. Oh, it's not a court anymore.
No, you can't see it. That was a clay court that belonged to the Johnstones. Mm. It was the only court in town.
Mm.
Hollis Eldridge had a farm across the street here. He had horses up there, over here.
Uh-huh.
He had a great big stallion. It was some kind of a horse, and I used to ride. Gull Hill School was up where the Eagle Wing used to be. Where the post office is now, but that was a beautiful rolling field all the way up the hill. It was a hill.
It was a big hill there.
It was a big hill, and the Eagle Wing Inn sat there, and it was a Gull Hill School, a boys' private school that Llewellyn Henson ran. And it started as the war broke out here. He had a school in Italy, And he brought all these kids that he had that used, you know, the kids used to go to school in Europe before the war. That was the rich kids went to Europe. He brought them all back here. And he rented, or I guess he bought the place. And Vernon taught art there. And our social life revolved around the boys at Gull Hill School. And Vernon taught the art there. And my brother Peter went there. And there were a few local people that went to school there, but not many. Mm. And it was like a whole world had opened up because all these people were so sophisticated, you know, these boys. I mean, they weren't like high school here. I mean, there was one boy named Aachen Reichner, and he was used to click his heels and Heil Hitler, you know. He just came from Italy. Here he was going to school there, and he thought this fascist stuff was great. And we'd go, look at him like, who is this character? It was fascinating. But there was all kinds of people like that. It was a wild time. It was a lot of fun. And we used to go to dances where you even had dance cards, you know, with the name of the boys on it, would fill out their dance card. And I remember there was Seapine School over in Brewster was the girls' school. So those two schools would have dances. But I always went to the dances because Vernon taught there. So they had an undersea ball. And Vernon decorated the whole thing with undersea, and he had all the coins and the big chest and everything. And all the girls in Sea Pines were very, you know, straight arrow, so to speak. And they came in these,
right,
these lovely bouffant, whatever they were. And I came as a mermaid. And Vernon had made this costume for me, and they were pasted on me, and all this whole tail and all these little pasties. And if I wasn't the hottest thing.
You're still up to all the tricks, even back then.
Oh my!
The costumes.
God, everybody was shocked to see this mermaid. Well, it was an undersea ball, right?
Yeah, and, of course.
I mean, why did they wear these Gone with the Wind outfits? These girls had on. So it was lots of fun, shocking them.
That school probably didn't operate too long.
Well, it operated for 4 years. At least, because my brother went there for the full 4 years. It came just before the war broke out here, and when it had broken out in Europe. So that would be late 30s, like 38, 39, something like that.
Yeah.
And it was a big part of the town. And funny how people just don't remember those things.
Mm. Now that building is on Monument Road.
Right. That's exactly. Dave John, or
the O'Neills, Frank O'Neill's.
Yeah,
house.
But originally didn't
Dave
Dell
Johnson
put it over there?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Dave and Dell moved it over.
Right. Hmm. And isn't the rest of it up in East Ham as a motel, or is that some?
Oh, it might be part of it.
That's
yeah.
part of it. Remember they call it the
Eagle Wing Motel.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's part of it.
Okay, let's take a look at some of Vernon's work here.
When he first started to carve, he carved in this Philippine mahogany, which is very hard. And this Philippine mahogany, as you can see, this is sort of like the forerunner of the Snow Library one, mm-hmm. the lady in the sea and the mother. And that little thing up there is my mother, a mask he did. I can remember she had straws coming out and he did this mask. That's the only thing I have of my mother, no pictures.
Hmm.
And I still have the Chinese lady, and I have that silver bowl was a wedding present for my father. That's one of my favorite pieces. It's beautiful, isn't it?
Yeah.
He loved orchestra. He played, you know, he played the viola. And he played in orchestras with Thomas Nassie, the Cape Cod Symphony. So that was a painting he did of the symphony. 40s, early 40s. And this is...
Where would this symphony orchestra have been?
They practiced in Orleans and they played in Hyannis. It was a Cape Cod Symphony.
Hmm.
This was Lita and the Swan. I don't know if you get it. Can you see the Lita? You know this, it's a myth, a Greek myth, I believe. And Vernon always said that every artist has to do Lita and the Swan. There's a rape of Lita. You see, here's her knee, her foot. You see, and then the swan laying over Lita.
Oh, yeah.
On the wing. Can you get the picture now?
Yeah.
So he said every artist always does Lita and the Swan. So that was almost one of his first carvings. I think it's just a fish motif with the waves.
Mm-hmm. Where was this house located?
It's the old Thickerson house, and it goes down that road that the Kent's property is, or whatever the name of that road is now, I've never, what do they call it, Frostfish
Cove,
Cove or something like that. So this is his studio up in South Orleans. There's a bunch of studios up there, they're still, they're houses now. And I think that was his, one of his model, artist model, and that was his big pot-bellied stove. He had a studio there for a while. He also was a very good furniture maker, by the way. Look at the little things he could make. When he had an antique shop, oh, that, I don't think I even mentioned that, on Reinert Road, which my mother ran. And his father sent antiques down from New York State, and he'd copy them, I don't know, just for advertisement.
It's a great little Windsor chair.
Yeah, look at the little desk he made. And this, here's another little, he sold a lot of these little things. Little, I just, aren't they nice? Mm. Things like this. I have few samples of all the different things he did, but here's another one. I think this is lovely. A piece of soapstone. He loved to carve in soapstone. This is just a little painting, a little miniature. Then you see, became rather abstract in the early latter part. See, a little abstract boat.
Yeah, I like that. Carved.
Isn't it nice? I've got to get it framed. Never have. Sometime I will. And he gave these for Christmas presents to everybody. Then he'd make little boxes. He'd paint little boxes. And this particular box has his chess set, which he made. He made these chessmen, which he loved. He turned them on a lathe. And he played chess with Phil Malico and Bruce McCain. And this is his Baddock industry. And he sold a lot of these, a lot. When they had the antique shop, they had the Baddocks in the antique shop. And there are quite a few around, but they're pretty rare, actually. Mm.
This is a carving that really, to me, typifies Vernon's panels.
And his colors, that he always used these greens and blues.
Mm.
And it also is a very good example of his carving, because it is more than two depths, it's three depths of carving. I think that's important. You see, he carved there, one, two, and three depths. So this is an exceptionally good example of his work. Self-explanatory, a little dark, but I think it's a lovely piece. I use it a lot when I put plants around it and things like that. These two little paintings up next to it are Dan Joy's when he went to Greece, I think, one year. He gave them to me for Christmas.
Mm-hmm.
For many, many years, the birds, people wanted the shorebirds. And they were so distinctive because of the long beak he put on them. But I suppose that they're the sandpipers. But you can see a little boat right up there in the center of the, and a little sailboat here over here, and a shell. Typical of the Church of the Holy Spirit, the feeling of the church, the cross that is on the altar there. So he made a lot of little copies of these crosses, personal crosses, and he sold them. I can't tell you how many turned out. I mean, he has a cross on one side. It was a feeling that he had, the primitive.
That's a nice primitive look.
Mm-hmm. A few years ago, gosh, anybody can carve these things. It's so simple, isn't it? So I had Frank cut me out some crosses, and I started doing them. And I will show you the difference. Would you like to see the difference?
Yeah.
And I sold them down at Ethel Putterman's gallery, and I sell them up at the gift shop at the church. But they don't have, I can't duplicate, so they became my Christ crosses. And I'll show you one. My Christ crosses are, I don't mind that side. But then I try to make a face.
Let's see the business side.
You want to see the business side? No, don't laugh. We had a quartet in our family. I played the second violin, Vernon played. No, Joy played first violin. Peter played the cello, and my mother played the piano, and he played the viola. Well, we were awful, just awful. But he kept trying to make a quartet out of his family. And Vernon gave this to me when he got back from Alaska, the totem pole. And this was my one picture he gave me of his trip to Alaska. and I treasure it. But my mother ruined it for me because she said, "Vernon, it's a wonderful painting." She said, "But this reminds me of a woman's breast." And ever since then, I look at it, Tom Mott McKinley with the snow cap, and what do I see? This panel was up in Crouchard Galleries in New York for many, many years, all the time he was showing his paintings there. But this is an example of his, of the aluminum work he did. He did many plates and platters and buttons, and he carved them with a little chisel, just a hand chisel. And then he'd rub the black paint in to bring out the design.
Oh, I see, yeah.
But it was all freehand. There was no anything he pounded a design with. A hammer and a little chisel. It's a lot of work in that. This is probably the last paintings that he did were this particular abstract type of painting. 1947, so I don't think he painted much after that. Very little. I think that's an excellent example of his.
Mm.
Colors are similar, those blues and greens. And it's a rock harbor, of course.
Sarah, you were telling me that this is a self-portrait that Vernon did?
Mm-hmm. He did that over in his studio behind the house on Monument Road. And I was a young girl, and so it must have been in the 30s. And he had a mirror. And he'd look in the mirror, and he'd paint. I think it's a wonderful portrait of a young man. It's so like him. It's very expressive, don't you think? It's very powerful.
Mm.
I couldn't even hang that up for 10 years after he died. I couldn't even look at it. Now I can. But that is him.